Hello. Now that we have a nice looking character sheet, it's time to turn it into something more than a fancy data entry form, making it interact with the rest of Foundry. Essentially, aside from keeping the sheet up to date, there are two main things GMs and players might want to do with the character sheet during a game session: rolling some dice and sharing information with the GM and all the other players. Fortunately, the way Foundry is built, and most other virtual tabletops for that matter, these are both done the same way, that is, sending a message to the chat log. What I call rolling an item is when you click on an item in the character sheet and it creates a message in the chat log that usually has some information about the item, and optionally some additional buttons that you can click on, for instance, to make an attack roll. The first step to achieve this is to add buttons to the character sheet. We'll start with the shtick cards. In the handlebars template for the shtick card, we'll add a hyperlink to an icon, just as we've done in the past. Now remember, you can put whatever icon here. I'm using the one that represents 2d6, as this is the main type of dice roll in Feng Shui. I've added a CSS class called item-roll, which we'll add a click listener on, but only for the actor's owner. This listener is just going to retrieve the item and called the roll function, which we're about to define. We could do it here, but it's cleaner to let the item itself decide what it means to be rolled. For that, however, we need to create a custom item class, which we have managed to avoid doing until now. So I'll create an FS2 item class in a JS file of the same name. This class will extend the item class. We then need to register it as the default class for items by changing the entity class for items in the main config dictionary. And let's not forget to import the new class as well. Just like sheets, chat messages can be defined using handlebars templates, and that's what we'll do, creating a useful dictionary pointing to the appropriate template based on item type. This, by the way, is the reason why we placed item info in separate partials for the character sheet. This way, we can reuse those partials for rolling the items. In the roll function, we're only really doing one thing, which is calling chatMessage.create, passing it some object containing the required data. But we do need to prepare that data. First, we need to specify who the message is from by specifying the current user and currently speaking token using chatMessage.getSpeaker. Next, we need to prepare the content of the message. As you know, handlebars templates need an object as the context to get data from. We'll create this chat card data by taking a copy of the item's data and appending the item's owner. We don't need this right now, but since we're here, we might as well do it. Now that our data is ready, we can render the appropriate handlebars template and assign the result to the content property of our chatData object. Finally, we'll set chatData.roll to true. This will ensure that our message respects the user's message visibility settings by checking the role mode and adding the corresponding settings to our chatData. With that done, I can now open a character sheet, click on the dice icon next to a shtick's name, and it should appear in the chat log. This works, but it doesn't look the same as in the sheet. That's because the style sheets for the shtick cards look for an FS2E selector, and we don't have a simple way of adding that to chat messages, so we'll remove it. Some padding isn't quite right either, because .message-contents-display is set to block instead of flex. We'll have to change it globally. No idea if it's going to break other stuff, but we'll go with that for now. You'll have noticed that the card in the chat message also has that roll button, and we don't want that. But rather than copy-paste the template for just the chat card, we can add a parameter to it. In the handlebars template for the shtick card, I'll wrap those hyperlinks in an if statement, testing a variable called insheet, simply rendering the name of the shtick if this variable is false. We then need to set that value somewhere, which we'll do in the template for the actor sheet when we're calling the partial for the shtick card. Note that the HTML content in the chat log is saved, so if you make any changes to the message content, you'll have to send a new message to the log to see the changes. Our chat message is now free of useless buttons. Speaking of buttons, to keep the sheet looking clean, I'd like to hide those buttons and have them displayed only when the user hovers over the card. For that, we'll need to add some new CSS classes in our shtick card. First, we'll add a hidden class to the roll button, as well as a rollable class. The former will be associated with a CSS rule that sets the class display to none in order to hide it. The latter will serve as a marker to identify the elements that need to be toggled on and off. Finally, we'll add another marker class on the elements we want to hover on to toggle the button. I'm going to call this reveal-rollable. The JavaScript for this is pretty simple. In the sheet, we're going to find that reveal rollable class and listen to mouseover and mouseout events, binding them to a callback function called onToggleRollable. This callback will look for all children with the rollable selector and toggle that hidden class. There, much nicer. I'll do the same for additional gear off camera. Now is the time for actual automation, which I'll demonstrate with skill checks. I'll add a button next to the skill value like I've done before, but instead of the item role class, I will add a class called TaskCheck. Then we listen to a click event as usual, and at this point we have two options. We can do things the simple way or the advanced way. I'll show the simple way first, but in either method, ultimately the steps are the same. We create an instance of a role class, call the role function to generate the role result, and send it to the chat log using the toMessage function. Just like the messages we sent before, we need to pass some chat data, such as who is the message from. The role constructor needs two pieces of info, the role formula, and some data object from which to retrieve any variable found in the role formula. In FangTree, the basic formula for most roles is 1d6 minus 1d6, where the dice explode on a 6, then you add some value, also called the action value, and must exceed a target difficulty. We'll ignore the difficulty for now, so in Foundry terms, our formula is going to be 1d6x6 minus 1d6x6 plus at action value. The at in front of action value identifies it as a variable. Variables are really just paths in the role data object, and depending on the type of role you're making, it's perfectly acceptable to just pass an actor's or an item's data as the role data. You'll often see this done with actor data, so that people can refer to properties from the actor template, like the initiative formula found in system.json. But you don't have to, and you can build your role data from scratch if that works better for you. I'll create my own for reasons that will be apparent later. But first, I need to, as usual, retrieve the item to get the skill value, and make this the action value in my role data. And that's about the bare minimum to be able to roll dice from a character sheet. However, role-playing games are rarely that simple, and you'll often have various modifiers to your standard role, such as rolling with advantage in 5e, taking into account exhaustion or injuries, spell effects, etc. All of these will change the role formula for standard roles, and this is where we need to talk about how much automation to put in your system. Too little automation and you're not taking advantage of playing on a computer that can do the maths for you and your players. Too much automation and you're turning your tabletop RPG into a video game. Which is not a bad thing per se, but not every player or GM wants this, and doing this comprehensively would require a ton of work, as RPGs tend to be riddled with edge cases and exceptions to the rules. Speaking of which, FangTree is no exception to that previous statement, and for now, I'm going to draw the line at just making sure the core modifiers to standard checks are being applied automatically, ignoring shtick effects, but I might revisit them when I look into active effects in Foundry 0.7. For these reasons, and since this kind of role might be called from places other than the character sheet, for instance as a macro, a better option would be to package these roles into helper functions. Following the 5e pattern, I'll create a new JavaScript file called dice.js that is not going to contain a class but a set of functions. In the character sheet's code, these will be imported under the same dice namespace. Our first helper function is going to be TaskCheck. To begin with, I'm going to move over the code we had in the TaskCheck listener, because as I mentioned earlier, it's mostly the same. The action value is going to differ from check to check, so we need to make this a parameter of this function. There's going to be a lot of optional parameters, so for convenience, I'll pass all the settings as a single object. Next, we need to customize our role formula. In FangTree, you have two kinds of roles. Normal roles, as I've already explained, and closed roles, which is the same, except that the dice don't explode. So I'm going to create a base dice variable, which will be set to either 1d6 or 1d6x6, depending on a closed role parameter that's going to be added to the list of settings. Then we can create our base role formula doing some string interpolation so that we end up with base dice minus base dice plus action value. Now we can go back to the character sheet and replace the old code with a call to task check. However, we have a problem. We're currently relying on retrieving an item to get the action value. This is fine for skills, but this won't work for everything. But there is a solution: data attributes. In the HPS partial for skills, we can add a data attribute to our role button, which we can call data-action-value, give it the value of the skill, and in the callback function, pass that directly to the task check function. Now the code doesn't need to know where the action value comes from, which means we can use the exact same listener for other areas in the sheet, like the character stats, which I'll do in the background. Another thing you can do with a task check is spending a fortune point to add an extra non-exploding d6 to the result, but only if it's not a closed role. So we're going to add another setting to our function and test it to append a +1d6 to the roll formula. To roll with fortune, what we can do is make use of modifier keys we can get from mouse event data. In our task check button callback, we're going to use the shift key to enable rolls with fortune. Note that I'm not automatically deducting fortune points. Accidental rolls can happen, and this is one of those cases where too much automation can be a bad thing. The last thing we have to take into account in our task checks is impairment. You may remember that there are two ways to gain impairment in this system, from wounds and as a result of shticks of other effects. You may also remember that we didn't add fields for wound-based impairment or for total impairment in the template, as we can calculate those. This will require creating a custom entity class for actors, just like we did with items. In there, we'll override a function called prepareData. This is similar to getData, but getData only works in sheets, while modifications done in prepareData will persist on the actor. We're using the same class for different actor types, but only named characters have impairments, so we've got to filter mooks out. Then we can calculate the wounds-based impairment using the threshold. We can then save the sum of that plus the extra impairment property to a new property we'll call total. But our task check function currently doesn't know anything about the actor making the check. So we need to pass the actor data by creating yet another setting to the task check function and have the sheet callback pass it along. We can now add the impairment term to the role formula. Don't forget to add a space at the beginning. Note that I'm only adding this to the role formula if there is any impairment to take into account. The idea here is that I want to avoid having redundant terms in the role formula in order to keep it cleaner. And before we finish, we have to copy our actor data into the role data so that we can refer to its values in the role formula. We have covered most cases for task checks, but we haven't had an example of closed roles yet. There's actually only one case in this system, and that's the def check. As it is a special kind of task check, it deserves its own function, which we're going to call, well, defcheck. I realized halfway through recording this that reusing task check wasn't worth it, even though it does support closed roles, because there are too many differences. It will also give us a chance to learn how to create custom chat messages for dice rolls. But first, we need to roll the dice. I won't explain the roll formula, since it's not important, but it's worth noting that since all the variables are coming from the character, I can just pass the actor data as the roll data. Then we can call the roll function as usual, but this time we need to grab its return value, which is an instance of the roll class containing the results of the roll. Now we can use the render function and give it a custom handlebars template, which we're going to create shortly. Because render is an asynchronous function, we need to make our def check async too. As you'd expect, the return value of render is the rendered template. Next, we can create a message data object in which we can specify the speaker as usual, but this time we'll also set a content property which we'll set to the rendered role. We can then finally call the toMessage function as we did before. For the template, I'm going to do something simple for demonstration purposes. We're simply going to check the result of the role and display a message of failure if it's negative and a message of success otherwise. But in the spirit of transparency, we should probably make sure this message contains the breakdown of the role. In other words, include the standard role message. You could simply copy the Foundry template or rebuild your own depending on your needs. I'm just going to include the Foundry one as a partial, which I'll need to register as we've done in the past. Okay, all that's left to do is create a role button for this, which I'll skip over because it's nothing we haven't seen before. And with that, our def checks with custom chat messages are complete. We now have an almost fully functional character sheet, and that's where we're going to stop for today. We haven't done weapons yet, but we'll look at those next time, along with other ways of making the chat log interactive. Bye!